Hello students, hope you have gone through the previous lectures. Now we will start with the new chapter, that is bioavailability and bioequivalence. These terms are very new to you. What is bioavailability? Bioavailability is the rate and extent of absorption of unchanged drug from its dosage form. What is rate and extent? Means at what rate the drug is going into the systemic circulation, and extent is the amount of the drug which is going into the systemic circulation. So at what rate and how much the drug is going into systemic circulation, and the most important thing is that is the unchanged drug. It should be unchanged drug, and the rate and extent at which the unchanged drug will go from its dosage form to the systemic circulation is defined as bioavailability. If suppose the dose of a drug is same, suppose we take 110 mg capsule and 110 mg tablet of the same drug, suppose we take two dosage forms and the dose of the drug is same, that is 10 mg here also and here also 10 mg. The bioavailability of the drug from capsule and tablet will depend on various factors. That is, first is the pharmaceutical factor. Pharmaceutical factors means the size, the factors related to physicochemical properties of the drug and characteristics of the dosage form. For example, from the for example, if it is parenteral, then the for example, if it is dosage form is capsule and the other is tablet, the bioavailability will be higher in case of capsule compared to tablet, as the tablet has to be disintegrated first to go into the systemic circulation, whereas capsule is already in the form of disintegrated form or in the powdered form. But it has to be converted into powdered form first. So the bioavailability from the capsule will be higher compared to the tablet. Means the rate and the extent of absorption will be higher in case of capsule compared to the tablet. So different dosage forms provides different rate and extent of absorption. For example, from in case of solution, the bioavailability will be higher compared to the solid dosage forms. Next is the patient related factors. The bioavailability also depends upon the age, sex and other things of the patient. Like for example, if the patient is old, then he will depict lower bioavailability. If the patient is of younger age, he will depict higher bioavailability. So this is the second factor which can affect, that is patient related factors can also affect the bioavailability of the drug. Third factor, if the dosage is same, then the route of administration can also affect the bioavailability. How come? The parenteral route, in which whole of the drug is given into the systemic circulation, here the bioavailability of the drug will be 100% because whole of the drug has been provided into the systemic circulation into the blood. So the rate and extent of the absorption of the unchanged drug into the blood or the systemic circulation is bioavailability. If the route is parenteral, then the bioavailability will be 100%. So highest bioavailability will be observed in case of parenteral route, then in case of oral route, where absorption has to take place first and then it will reach into the systemic circulation, then rectal route and then the topical route. So you have to remember that we obtain 100% bioavailability in case of parenteral route. Now what is bioavailable fraction? This is a term used in the bioavailability, that is denoted by F, and it is known as bioavailable fraction. How it is determined? It is determined by the bioavailable dose divided by administered dose. For example, we have given 10 mg of the drug to a patient, and from the 10 mg, suppose it has gone, around 8 mg has been entered the systemic circulation. That means bioavailable dose is 8 mg that has entered systemic circulation, and the administered dose was 10 mg. Then the bioavailable fraction will be 0.8. Okay, highest bioavailable fraction can be 1. how it can be one. If suppose we have given 10 mg and the 10 mg have reached systemic circulation, then it becomes 1. So highest bioavailable fraction can be equal to 1, and it is determined by the division of bioavailable dose divided by administered dose to the patient. It can be administered by any route. If it is given by a parenteral route, then the bioavailable fraction will be always be 1, because whole of the drug has been given to the or has been administered into the systemic circulation. So bioavailable dose will be also 10 mg, or and it will be administered dose will also be 10 mg, and it will become as 1. But however, in other cases it is always less than 1. Other factors that can affect what are the objectives of determining now bioavailability? What is the need why we determine bioavailability of a drug, or the fraction of the bioavailable fraction? What is the need why we are determining these things? First important objective of bioavailability studies is development of a dosage form for a new drug entity. Suppose we have formed a tablet of any drug. Suppose there was any new chemical entity which has been synthesized, and we have developed tablet for that. That means there was a new drug entity, new chemical, and we have formed a new dosage form for that tablet. How will you come to know whether this tablet will show therapeutic efficacy in the body or not? It will directly depend on the bioavailable fraction. So therefore, there is need to determine the bioavailability of that new entity. So first objective depends where we develop new drug entity. We develop new dosage form for a new drug entity. So we will require bioavailability studies. Second important point where the bioavailability studies are considered is development of a new formulation of existing drug. Suppose a tablet was already available for a chemical or for a bioactive or a drug, tablet was available, but now any other company forms capsule for the same, then how will the tablet, previous tablet, will be compared with the new capsule? How it will be compared? With the help of bioavailability. If this capsule depicts higher bioavailability compared to this tablet, then it will be employed for further use. So bioavailability can be done for the new drug entities. It is also done for the new formulation of the existing drugs. It is also done for quality control purposes. What are quality control purposes? Before the drug enters into the market, or during the early stages of marketing, in order to determine the influence of processing factors. For example, processing factors include means the method of preparation or some other things, and other storage conditions, what they can influence are also determined with the help of bioavailability. That means it also helps in the quality control. And the next factor which bioavailability studies are done is to determine the influence of various factors. For example, different excipients are used. In case of one dosage form, one type of excipient is used, and in second case, second type of excipient is used. How it is determined which excipient is better, one or two, then it can be determined with the help of bioavailability studies. If the excipient which gives better performance in case of bioavailability stabilities will be selected. Some other factors such as patient related factors or possible interaction with other drugs are also determined with the help of bioavailability studies. So there are four objectives wherein bioavailability studies are considered. First is the development of a dosage form for a new drug entity. Second is the development of a new formulation of the existing drug. Third is for quality control purposes, and the fourth is for determining the influence of various factors such as excipients, patient related factors. Go through these, then we will go with the further matter related to bioavailability. Okay, thank you students.